16 by 16 by 16. What would you do with such a small space in Minecraft? Would you build a house? Because surely making something more complex like a fully autonomous Minecraft CPU surely isn't possible. But what if I told you I did just that? Now let's talk about what exactly this CPU can do. So as you can probably tell, it's pretty small, compact, and there's not much room for anything. As you may have read, this CPU only has enough space for 7 instructions, so it can't run very large programs. If you want to make the program stop, you actually have to add a halt instruction, which only leaves 6 instructions for the actual program. So you can work around this by not adding a halt instruction, and this way the program will loop infinitely, and this is what I did for the Fibonacci program demo. Additionally, this CPU technically has a load immediate, basically a way to write a number from the ROM into the RAM. There's not enough bits in the instruction to store both the value and the address, so I made it so that the number and the address are stored in the same place, so if you want to write a 0 to the RAM, it'll be stored in register 0. But anyway, why would you store data through instructions when you only have 7 instructions in the first place? Just debug stick your way into the RAM. You might also have noticed that the CPU has a word size of 4, meaning it can only count up to 15, and this is because to store this data or calculate stuff with it, you realistically need 2 blocks in height to store 1 bit. So if I were to make this CPU 8 bits, then something like the ALU would already take 16 blocks in height. And this causes 2 major issues. First, this is 16 blocks in height, so there's no way to transfer information from one side to the other. And second, you physically can't add a decoder to know which RAM register you're trying to access, so I chose 4 bits. In case you actually want to use the CPU and try to code your own programs, here's the instruction set. Just know that ABF, which means ALU buffer, will flush the buffer into like basically something unpredictable. And also know that copy replaces both the source and the destination with the source value. Now comes the fun part, and it's how to reset the CPU. This is actually pretty tedious, and this is why I built these modules, these reset modules you may have seen in the demo. And they're not mandatory, they just make your life easier when resetting, but the CPU works fine without them, of course. So you still have to do a lot of things though. First, you have to stop the CPU if it's still running by pressing this stop button. Then you now have to reset the program counter. Now we need to reset all the buffers, starting with the RAM that will write 0 in each register. So to make sure you're actually inputting zeros, you have to flick this lever on to cancel any signal coming in. So now you can use the RAM reset module. Now for the remaining registers, you go here and press this button. Flick the lever off. And remove this dust for a few moments. Now the last things we need to do are simply to press these two buttons to unload any halt instructions still in the system, which will then allow us to press this button, which will re-enable the clock for future use. Now that's it, what a journey. I'll now provide, if I don't forget, a schematic in this description with the CPU, the reset modules, and the 7 segments so that I can test programs. I'll preload it with the Fibonacci program maybe. And with that, keep on redstoning and I'll see you next time.